some people that like your Facebook page? Right. Your book? Instagram? Snapchat? Is God still good?
Yes.
Is he in your comments? It's good to see everyone. Welcome to everyone. God bless you. My name is Mark. Who's had a good week?
Oh, man. Yeah.
And for the rest of the people, you had a bad week? And for the other people that are confused? Not sure? God is good?
All the time.
All the time?
Good.
Okay, so today I'm going to be preaching. I've got three words for you. Enough, enough, enough. Amen?
Amen.
So these three enoughs are different. Because one enough is God is enough. Second enough is, that's enough for that. And then third enough is enough for me. Amen?
Amen.
So if you want to take notes, you're more than welcome. But if you're going to maybe take them in steps, because they're going to merge straight into one another. Yeah? Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Who knows that God is enough to sustain you through your trial?
Yes.
Does anybody know what sustain you? Yeah, what does he stay in?
He leads you there.
Stable? See you through?
Yeah.
Will you lack, you will feel? Is that true? Maybe some of you guys will lack the grace towards other people, but will feel that it's before you in your heart. So it's not like that.
Sometimes.
When you're willing, it's good. Can anyone remember a certain circumstance that God made it sustain you through? And you felt like you couldn't? Anyone? Is there any many times? So when I talk about trials, what's your first thought?
I'd like to hear some feedback.
For those who are regular comers, I like to interact, so I like to hear you speak and shout if you want. So when I say trials, what kind of suffering would you say that is?
Challenges.
Challenges? What kind of challenges? You can stand up and say your name. What kind of challenges? So what kind of difficult challenges in your life that you will see that is difficult? Well, what? Maybe one would be a relationship step. Can that be one? Sorry? Family? What would you find challenging about your family?
Being annoyed?
Anyone else? Staying obedient is a challenge? Finance?
Sickness.
Yeah. Praise God. So you can say physical suffering, emotional suffering, psychological challenges. Anybody know what psychological challenges are?
Mental
challenge. Anyone here mentally challenged? So I would say everyone. No one knows what that is. Because do you know that you are in a war within yourself? As Paul mentioned, that I find a war within my members. My flesh and spirit are sinning against each other. Would you say that's a mental thing? So, pretty sure everyone will go through some psychological challenges in their life. Maybe that word you might not understand, but mentally challenging. What about spiritual challenges? Spiritual suffering. Anybody know about spiritual suffering? Yeah? You all know that Papa Adam knows about spiritual suffering. Yeah? Is anyone you think of in the Bible that might have suffered by spiritual? Sure.
Four.
Job more so physical, he must have been. I would say Paul. And Paul would be sort of like the main person I'll be talking about today. Cool? Yeah. Did someone say something? Just me, bro. So Paul went through a lot of suffering. So we're going to go into the scriptures about what kind of suffering he actually went through. So this message, I'd like to encourage you guys to be ready to receive and acknowledge that. Because the first step to recovery is what? Accepting that you do have a problem, true? How many people like to accept that they have a problem? Okay. Well, not a lot of people. They don't feel good saying that I'm an alcoholic or like a smoke or I do things behind the door that people don't answer me and stuff like that. It's very confronting, true? Yeah. Amen? But as Christians, what are we called to do? Yeah? Bring it to the light. You know, the truth is like, so a lot of people, they've shared about when we first get saved, you're filled with this compassion, this fire of Christ. Yes? So your spiritual feeding that's been, so your spiritual man that's starved for so long is finally getting his feeding that it rightfully deserves. And it's getting exercise. Yes? So anybody here exercise? You can't include work as your exercise? Actual real exercise. So in order for you to gain more stamina, more endurance, more strength, build muscle mass, you gotta exercise, yes? So when you lift weights, for some people that lift weights, what you're actually doing is tearing your muscle, and then when it heals over. So, and tearing, like, if anyone's done like a hectic workout, then that's good to be done, right? Because there's a lot of benefits. You become more active and you're physically more capable of doing things than you couldn't before. Okay? So it's the same as a spiritual man. A spiritual man needs to be exercised. So when we first come to Christ, we get that training there. And after that, your spiritual levels need to be fit. So there's always a spiritual hunger that always needs to be met. Yes?
Yeah.
Does anybody physically get hungry?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a spiritual self. The spiritual self gets hungry as well. What would be some of the signs of that spiritual hunger? Try with this drying. So what's a sign of becoming spiritually hungry?
Spiritually hungry?
Yeah. What's a sign of being spiritually hungry?
Lacking?
What about your emotion? So you'll say a lot to do with your passions, how you see your day. So if you wake up dreading to go to work, perhaps you're spiritually angry. What happens to you when you don't eat much? You start to get run out of energy. You just want to give up, or you don't want to bother. Isn't this spiritual self? When you start to lose that compassion, that fire that is within inside yourself, it starts of becoming spiritually angry. Amen? Okay, cool. So let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, please. And we'll start reading from verse 22. The 31. I'll give you a minute to get there. So if you want a title for your notes, enough. God is enough. And then you have it. So it's on the board. I'd really like for you guys to read it. So if you still don't have it, it's up on the screen. Can we read this together? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. If anyone's going to be nervous to read this, it'll be me, but I'll get it wrong and I'm right. They love this, let me just keep going. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, starting from verse 32 to 31. 3, 2, 1. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool, I am more. In labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths often. Of the Jews, 5 times you see, out of 40 stripes, save one. Christ was I beaten in blood, once was I stoned, right? An example of a natural consequence would be somebody taking, someone going to work without eating, and someone constantly tells them, eat for strength or whatever. We all know that our strength comes from the Lord. And this person says, you know, pushes themselves at work, and then they faint. Would that be a natural consequence? So consequences are things that happen according to things that you do. Yes?
Yeah.
Consequences?
Yep.
Everybody knows the consequences of their words and actions? Yeah?
I just want to make sure that everyone
will go. So natural consequences will be the example. I'll give another example. So say for example a little boy refuses to clean his room. Mommy and dad tell him clean your room, doesn't clean his room. Mommy and dad will teach him a lesson, so they leave. A lot of parents like to walk. Your children to clean their room, which I wouldn't encourage. But so these parents took a different approach and allowed the child to not clean the room, get him on a month, get him to do everything up and down. And then one day the boy comes up to mom and dad and says, "Have you seen this toy? I can't find this toy." They said, "Check in your room, should be in your room." He says, "I can't find it." "Why can't you find it?" "Because it's a mess." So what's the boy supposed to do? He's got to clean his room in order to what? So sometimes for us in life, we go through natural consequences. When we don't focus on our walks as believers, we suffer. We suffer because they are the consequences of our actions. Why? Because we're not reading, we're not fellowshipping, we're not praying, we're despising one another. Paul goes through his suffering for the sake of Christ, because he pursues the righteousness of God and his holiness. Amen? So I want to take these to 2 Corinthians chapter 12, starting from verse 7 and 10. Give you a minute there. Is God enough?
Amen.
Is God enough?
Amen.
So we did? 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 76. And if we can, 7 to 10.
Sorry.
Can we start? 1, 2, 3. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the Satan to buffet me. Lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord Christ, that he might depart from me. And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Lest gladly therefore will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore I take pleasure in my infirmities, in my reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Amen? So there's a few words in there that I'd like to point out. What do you reckon they are? Infirmities? Reproaches? Persecution, necessities, distresses. Amen? So when God says His grace is sufficient, what does that mean?
To you.
Is it enough? Is God enough?
Yeah, absolutely.
So when we go through testing trials, what do you think we don't overcome? If God is enough to sustain us through this trial, why do we still struggle?
Unbelief.
Unbelief? Something to do with unbelief.
Christ is not enough.
Christ is not really enough. Relationship? Anyone else? See, there can be so many different situations. Something that actually the Apostle Paul shared a long time ago. There can be thousands and thousands and thousands of issues. There's always one solution. It's Jesus. Amen? Depending on your situation, it will vary on how you go in your approach. On why Jesus is enough. So is God enough for you? Is Jesus enough? Sometimes we struggle because of we've forgotten the value of our soul.
Yeah,
true?
Yeah.
Sometimes we forget how valuable we are to God. Why would God buy it for me? Like the song of the apostle that I sang is very touching. Why would you choose me? And it's something that I shared with my daughter. And I asked my daughter, why do you think that he loves you? And she says to me, because I'm a good girl. It's like, no. Because I do what I'm told. It's like, no. And she says, it's a whole lie. She said, I love you because of my daughter. There's nothing you can say or do that will change my love for you. My love will always be for you. And it'll last. It's like that. Amen?
Amen.
So God's love for you, we are all his what?
Children.
We are God's children.
Amen.
And God's, say compassion.
Compassion.
Compassion?
Capacity.
Capacity. What?
Capacity. Am I saying wrong words or what?
You're mumbling.
I'm mumbling?
Nah. Nah, we heard wrong.
Say capacity.
Capacity.
What's capacity?
The amount you can contain.
So capacity is the area of something can hold, yeah? So the capacity of a 1 liter bottle will hold what?
1 liter.
So is there a limit to God's capacity? It's overflowing, amen?
Amen.
And what about us little humans? What about us little humans? What do we have within us that needs to be filled?
Blood.
Some said blood.
Love.
Love. Love. Yeah. So when Paul sought the Lord thrice, three times, about a certain bond in his flesh, what did God say to him?
My grace.
For what? Why is his grace sufficient?
For when I meet you, God.
But when you are weak, he's strong. So testing trials are actually to what?
Strengthen
us to show us as much by our own ability that we are chosen or the elect. It's just like the armor of God. What do you think Paul talks about in Ephesians about taking on the whole armor of God that you may withstand the devil? Because everything part of that armor has nothing to do with you. It all comes from God. So you can know that through your time for struggle, that God is the answer. Amen?
Amen.
Yes?
Yes and amen.
God is enough?
Yep. Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Yeah, that's my first half. God is enough. His grace is sufficient to help you through your time to struggle. Any struggle, all struggle. Emotional, physical, financial. See, me and my little family, we survived with one income for the past 7 years. God's enough. And sometimes we have some hardships. My wife would say, well, what are we going to do? And I'm saying, my wife, what are we going to do? We have a little quote with my family, and it's always a good time to struggle. We say, God will help us. God will help us. We do the best that we can, and God will fulfill the rest. Amen?
Amen.
So the second enough. Anybody remember what the second enough is?
Enough of that.
Enough of that. Look at that thing.
That.
That.
Maybe
someone's.
That thing in the way.
That thing?
Yeah.
Enough of that. So the first one is enough of God. The second is enough of that. And this is in the context of me using that word is more for your brother. Look to your brother. Say enough of that.
Enough of that.
Turn to your other brother. Say enough of that. Be cheerful in what you do. God's
The same which I also was called to do.
So what's it talking about, this situation? Someone was compromising. Who was compromising?
Peter.
Was Peter a mighty man of God?
Yes.
Yes. Do we all make mistakes?
Yes.
Is God enough?
Yes.
Yes. So what did Paul do?
Rebuked
him. Where was he? Did he go and tell one of his close mates? Did Paul go and tell Barnabas, say, hey, little Peter's doing this kind of talk? He said, enough of that. We stood into the face, yeah? Amen? Now, I'm not saying this is the approach for all, but for certain circumstances, it is. Amen? That's why we pray that your heart is right, and you ask God, when's the right time to do it? Or if he even wants you to do it. Some people have so much to say to others, but they should be directing that to God. If you've got something to say about someone, say it to God. Yes? Praise God. God is good?
All the time.
Okay, let's go to Acts chapter 21, please. Paul also included in this one. Put on the board. Acts chapter 21, verses 1 to 15. Now, I want you to pray. I don't want you to just read like zombies or robots. I want you to read it and actually absorb what the story. Yes, please. You going to jump in? Everyone, yeah, everyone. You can dramatize it if you want. Put some different voices in there. Look at that. Yeah? He's ready?
Yep.
1, 2, 3.
For the
we read in verse 4? Can we read in verse 4, please? All together? 1, 2, 3. And finding disciples, he tarried there 7 days, who set for Paul through the Spirit, that he should not grow up in truth. That Paul shouldn't what? And what does 15 say? They went to Jerusalem. Yeah? Let's go to verse 10. 10 and 11. Ready? 1, 2, 3. And as we tarried there many days, there came down from Judea a certain prophet named Agabus. And when he was come unto us, he took forth girl and bound his own hands and feet, and said, Thus saith the Holy Ghost, so shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man that owneth his girl, and shall deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. So was Paul told how many times?
Twice.
He told once, and then he was warned, this is what's going to happen to you when you get to Jerusalem. And then what did the brethren do? They told him, please, Paul, don't go. Don't go. And then what does Paul? Paul makes his big speech.
Yeah?
Why do you need your tears? Try and stop me. Even if I die in Jerusalem, I'll go. But what did the brethren do after?
The Lord's will be done.
The Lord's will be done.
Yeah, amen.
The Lord's will be done.
And then
what did they do after?
They went to Jerusalem.
They went to this. True? So you as brethren, how many of you guys have warned your brethren? How many of us warned your brothers and sisters? And there's no limitation. There's no limitation as to how many times you can tell your brethren, but there's a wisdom of how. Amen? And then, so the root Paul, journeying Paul, a prophet tells him, and then he's warned by somebody else from the disciples, and then his disciples try and tell him not to go, but he still goes. And then the brethren pray for him. God's will be done. But then the brethren go with him to Jerusalem. Even though they know the fate that Paul might face. Is that brotherhood or what? So my question to you is, how often are you applying that to your world? When we say enough of that, are you actually talking to your brother face to face? I have to have. See, for me, for those who are keeping contact with me over the phone, they know that I don't like texting. I'm not a fan of texting. I misinterpret things, and sometimes you misinterpret me. But I'm a face to face person. And what this world we live in is creating is that you don't have to face someone anymore. Can you talk?
Yeah.
Yeah? We're slowly leaking into a cashless society where we don't have to talk to people. We talk to machines on the phone now, and we have to wait for a robot for the other person on the other line to stop drinking their coffee and talking before they pick the phone up. If you are watching and praying, then you won't know the signs of the devil pulling you away from what God has intended you to do. One of the brethren asked me one day, as a pastor, as a shepherd, as a flock, what's your number one thing that you need run from the flock? You want to know my answer? Can you guess what it was?
Be real.
Be real. Be real. But if there's one thing that I expect from you is your honesty. Because that's what I'll give you. I'll give you my honesty. If people are being real with each other today, what's the point of coming to church?
Amen.
What's the point of coming to church? If you're not coming to church to be refined, to be improved, to be renewed, in your reproaches, in your necessities, in your infirmities, in your trials, then what's the point of coming? I remember I said before, and I'm not saying because I'm perfectly saying because God's told me to. Even if we have to sit in here by myself, I'm sitting here by myself and talk to God. But I'd rather have one honest person in my church than to have 10 friends. Or a million friends. I'd rather have one person that's willing to live for God.
Amen.
Because that's what God came to establish.
Amen.
People that have, because why? Why would I do like that? Why would I expect honesty? Why would I sit in here by myself? Because I remember what God done for me. I lived a life full of hurt, pain, and suffering, and purposeless. And that's what I hold on to. I hold on to purpose. Because God's given me a purpose. What's your purpose in life? You just come here on a Saturday just to show your face? If you are, just keep. But I'm being honest, like, I'm being gentle with you. Like, look here, I don't have much enemies. Well, I probably have a lot. But I don't intend to make enemies. It is what it is. God's not going to say, you can't see. God can see through anything in him, even to the intentions of your heart. But you know, when someone says, I think he's doing this, and this dude doesn't even know what he's talking about, and she's gone and told someone else, and all this gossip talk, what happens? Does anybody know what an innocent bystander is?
Yeah.
Someone who gets shot down in the middle of a conflict?
Yeah.
And why did conflict start? Assumptions?
Gossip.
Misinterpretation, right?
Misinterpretation?
Yeah. What if you have a problem with someone? Okay? I'm gonna give you like the result that you're gonna need will be in this kingdom. I share with my wife, there's an equation to everything. There's a formula and the way you should do something. Everything, no matter what it is, there's always a formula to the why you should do something. If you disagree, depending on this, I believe there's a formula to everything.
Amen.
In order for you to get results,
yeah,
or conclusion. Sometimes me and my wife argue when we talk about how to argue. Because if you don't know how to argue, then you'll be going around in circles. And it just means more stress. Yeah? Is it bad to argue?
No.
Is it bad to disagree?
No.
I remember hearing a guy share one day. He goes, imagine if people were ducks. And when ducks swim in the same pond and another duck ventures into another duck's territory, they sort of like at each other and then rustling the feathers, and then they swim away. And that's it. There's no bitterness or anything like that. They had their clash. When they finished, then they looked at it. What if us as humans had a disagreement, came together? Whether you think, and your outcome can be this, you agree to disagree. That can be your outcome. You agree that you disagree. Okay, say it. Finish. That'll stop a lot of people getting caught up in the crossfire. If one brother had a problem, another brother had a problem, and they both knew it, and they came together and they solved it. Enough of that. Amen? Enough of that, gospel. Enough of that. If you go, I say it to people a lot of the times, and a lot of people come to me and say, oh, so-and-so told me I can't do this, and so-and-so I can't do that, whatever. I said, look, you have my approval, go and do it. If somebody has a problem with it, turn and come and talk to me. Guess what happens? No one comes and talks to me. I'm not going to bite your head off or it's going to be down, pass down, whatever. I can't do that. You're like, this church belongs to Jesus. Amen? I can't stop anyone from coming in. Maybe pray you out. We can do that. That's God. That's only if it's some sort of situation very extreme. But for the sake of being real, and it doesn't have to be rude to this person, be rude to that person, be rude to yourself. If you haven't bought a door for yourself, like, no watering down words. If you're not rude to yourself, then you will fail. But that's what I don't want to be. Because I grew up in a life full of fakes. Fake pastors, fake friends, fake family. Okay, I'll buy them hard, but I'm not. If you're going to be rude for yourself, because God can see your heart, and at the end of the day, you stand before the Lord. But why did you fake church for 15 years? You come here and you fake in front of people, why fake church? What are you going to say? Oh, because of this person and that person, this person, the pastor wasn't doing his job, the apostle didn't solve this issue. At the end of the day, everyone will stand before the Lord by themselves. Amen?
Amen.
Going back to dealing with situations, use as brethren. If be genuine, do it according to how God wants you. Sometimes when I can't come to a conclusion, and if I think that God wants me to speak to someone, I say, Lord, you set it up. And he does, 100%, all the time, he sets it up for me. I say, thank you, Lord, and I take the opportunity. Yes? Amen?
Enough of that?
God is good? All the time? What's our last enough? Enough of you. Yeah? Is it possible to do something that seems godly and not have love in it?
Yeah.
So is it possible to come to church, clean the whole church, play some music, dance to God, stand behind the mic, sing for God? Is it possible to do that without love?
Yes.
Does anyone here disagree? You don't have to put your hand up or read the scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, please. And this works to me all the time when I read this. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Can we read the whole chapter?
Yeah.
Please? It's only 13 verses. So we'll try and read this with some enthusiasm. Yeah? Ready? 1, 2, 3. Grace is what?
Charity.
What's charity?
Love.
Is it your love?
No.
God's love?
Yes.
Is it limitless?
No.
Is it limitless?
No.
Is God's love limitless?
No.
Is God's love limitless? Limitless obviously means there's no limit. That's why you didn't answer that word. Yeah. So, can we go to Acts chapter 16, please? This is another example of doing things that might seem holy and godly, but there's no love in it. Praise the Lord. Acts chapter 16, verses 16 to 18, please. 1, 2, 3. Oh, is that what it's sorry? Enough. You ready? Yes.
Yep.
1, 2, 3.
Stay there and go like this. Look around, get out of the car, check if there's a car coming.
traffic on the other side has stopped in order for you to go to the green light? Yes? Yes? Or when you go to work for someone? Everyone that goes to work for someone, they expect to be paid. Level of faith, trusting that person that they will pay you after your labor. Some people probably do ripped off. Amen? So, measure of faith. So, what would I say that? The denizen, the spirit of divination. So, they can even be amongst us. Yes? They can even be, it could be even one of you. The life you live, is it really for Christ or is it for you? I don't know the strictly to glorify God. What does glorify mean? Anyone? To exalt? To give? Empty your pockets and give it all to Him? You stand under your seats, there's an envelope there, you see that? If you don't know what I'm talking about. Anyways, God is good. So I want to go to my last scripture, which will be Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. Right, my last scripture doesn't mean that I'm going to stop straight away, but the last scripture. Get into it. Revelation chapter 2, 1 to 7. Key verse will be 4. I'll elaborate more on that after we finish reading. If we can read it together, will that be okay?
Yes.
Yeah? Have you had enough? Should I stop? Some of you might. Say this in your mind. Some of you will. Okay, ready? Revelation chapter 2, 1 to 7, 1 to 3. Amen? Thank you. So if you don't know, Jesus speaks to a few of the churches in the book of Revelation, but Ephesians is one of them. Ephesus. So with this church, where were they going wrong?
Lack of love.
They neglected the first love. Were they doing good things though?
Yes.
Did they have works? Did they have patience? They couldn't bear those who were evil. They exposed false apostles. They labored for the sake of Christ and they fainted not. But he still had something against them. One thing. Even though they had done all these things, which was that they left their first love. Remember when I said you spiritually become hungry? Anybody been in a relationship that started to die out? Yeah? Any men? You're probably the one that killed him. Praise the Lord. So in order for a relationship to keep going, what needs to happen? Communication. communication or bad communication? So good communication, bad communication. Yeah, once in a while. You put four roosters up every once in a while. Right? So there has to be a constant connection. Yeah? 24/7. There has to be a constant connection. Always. If there isn't, then you start to forget what he's supposed to have. You forget why you love him. You forget why he loved you. It's very important for you to focus on your walk as Christ. Something the brother shared before. If this is broken, this is broken. That means if your connection with God is broken and your connection with people will be broken. Whether that person is your mom, your dad, your partner, your sibling, your children, or your boss, doesn't matter who it is, if your relationship with God is not strong. Jesus is in the center of it. If he's not the center of it all, expect that there'll be hardship. And when I say hardship, I mean self-inflicted hardship. Yeah? Because we are called to suffer as believers of Christ, how suffering may come will vary. Of what God has called you to be. Amen? But you know what I love about that chapter? Is that God encourages us. He encourages us. Can we read 5 and 6 again? Ready? 1, 2, 3. Destruction of people, a sect mentioned in Revelations, who were charged with holding the error of Babylon, casting a stumbling block before the church of God by upholding the liberty of eating things sacrificed to idols as well as committing fornication. Praise the Lord. So if you didn't know, now you know. So when it comes to living a life, is your life hidden Christ? What does it mean your life is hidden Christ?
All they see is
Jesus. What was it? Jesus is alive and we are dead. Amen? So when you go evangelizing on the street and you tell someone that Jesus is alive and I am dead, make sure you change your Christian language, your Christianese to English, because an unbeliever won't understand that term. Yes? God just as we whispered. We are dead, and Christ is within us. She says, no longer I say live by Christ. Yeah? So all our thoughts, desires, and wants now become Christ. But are they? Oftentimes I'll ask someone a question, and I'll say to them, give me the answer that you have within your heart. Then give me the answer that you already have in your mind. Because people know what to say, but they don't know what to do. Is that true? Sometimes we like to try and... Some people like to breathe through life, live through life. But a Christian life, you can't do that. You can't just hang back and let everyone do the work. do their job as a believer. As a believer. The church will be much more helpful. Are we going to grow as a church? Absolutely. We're going to grow. Much better compared to what we were last year and the beginning of this year. Would some of you disagree? Yeah. If you aren't, then maybe we should sit together and pray together. But what? The church, what? What makes the church is not the leaders. Leaders can't make the church. They're just called to look after it. The fivefold ministry is to help edify the church, bring the church up, rebuke the church. We're made for that. But we're not going to put our arms in your arms, in your legs, and walk for you or try and sing for you. Some of you have had an easy life where mom and dad have done anything for you. It's now time to take some responsibility over your life and do something. You've all got a purpose in Christ. My purpose in life is that I mean something to someone. That's my purpose. I mean something to someone. That's all I need. This year has been one of my hardest years ever. So put last year and the year before that I had together, this trial didn't amount to the ones that I've been through this year. Why? Because of myself, yes, but also because of the times. Amen? We live in a time where, you look around you, the world we live in is not getting any better. If you're a Christian and you're praying for the world to get better, because of bad news for you, because you prophesied that it's going to fade away. So don't worry about yourself, don't worry about where you're going to be after. So just pray and ask God, seeking for guidance. Like I shared with you, if there's anything that I expect from you, it's your opposite. Be real. There's some people here that you might not know. I won't say anything. Some of them have sworn at elders, wanted to fight elders, and have had spoken things against them. To their face. And I'm thankful for that. Why am I thankful for that? Okay, you have a problem. I know that. Let's do something. If you want to get better, I'm here to help you. But if you've got a problem, and you're swearing bad at all, or you're doing things that are kind of edifying, possibly sharing things that are unedifying. And this is for you as believers, that he and other believers doing this. So if you remember, Paul says, if someone brings any other doctrine other than Christ, if what Christ informed in his church, what Christ has established in his church, the peace and grace and the theology, the mercy that we have in his church that God has blessed us with, if we disagree, we're more than happy to talk about it. If you're going to say behind, whether it be our backs or top part of somebody else's back, like, I'm coming from here, she's working, she's going to church, that's kind of lovely. Can you believe how high the shirt is? You're a lovely. Can I just give everyone some advice? Pray and ask God to help you, because sometimes people's interpretation isn't the same as yours. You know? For some reason, I'm drawn to people that need help. I need help myself, so maybe I feel better myself helping people than I need help. And sometimes I talk to... I'm gonna share an analogy of my brother Nat. Alright, I love you, bro. Nothing against Nat. I love Nat. Otherwise, it wouldn't be in my house. Alright? So... I'm trying to learn, because the way the mind works, it intrigues me. I'm really intrigued by why. Like, if somebody does something, I think this is my thought process. Why did you do that? What? So like this lady at work, right? This lady at work, we all line up before the clock to clock off. And she, we all were on her mind. And she just walks all the way to the front, stands in front of the clock. And she just thinks he's smirks at all the boys. And then when it's time to pop off, she pops off and walks off. She pushed him in front of all these guys. I'm sitting there amazed. Like, I don't feel angry or bitter, I don't want to tell her off. It just amazes me promised man is standing here lining up. So then, I wanted to sit on a little bit. So one day we were standing there, and then all the boys are standing there, and then she comes up and does it again. I said, oh, push it in again, eh? And then all the boys started talking about it, and whatever. I regret, but it was good. So, one day I asked Nara, oh, Nara cut the grass. And in the back corner was like some tree branches that I had to strip off the tree. And I laid it in a pile to chuck it in the bin. And so, he cuts the grass, I come home, he goes, see the awesome work that Nara does. I've got a good job. And then, it wasn't until I went outside that, I have a dog, and so I look at the back corner and the tree branches are still there, and there's grass sticking up underneath the branches. So for me, common sense will be pick it up, cut on the rope, and then put it back. So then when Mark gets home, I think he was a little bit startled when I pulled him up, because I said, I've got a question for you, bro, and I need you to be as honest as possible. He goes, yeah, I'm being honest, alright? He goes, yeah. I said, you know when you cut the grass? He goes, yeah. I said, you know when you saw the branches there? Did it ever occur to you in your mind to pick it up, cut underneath it, and put it back? He looked at me, and he goes, honestly, bro, no. I said, yeah. He goes, yeah, you know, because I thought, the branches are there, I don't want to run them over the home wall. So, I want to let you on it. I want to share with you guys. That's the humorous side of different interpretations, different perspectives, different minds. I wasn't angry at Mark because I understand how his mind works. Some of these are for me, the way I trust people is I trust them into their work. And if that people forgiveness, I forgive them and trust them into their work. Why? Because God says if somebody sins against you, how many times should you forgive them in a day? 600 and something? 490? Well, whatever the number is, you keep on forgiving. Jesus will come, remember that. Yeah? So before you make the assumption of someone, and I want to let you know a little insight about yourself. Okay, who here has had a struggle in life? Anyone? Who here has gone through some trauma in life? And trauma can be like neglect, rejection, put down, abandoned, mistreated, maybe a lack of funds. Yeah? Maybe you didn't have money to buy other toys, so you use rocks and sticks as toys. You probably know about that life. You're on the same page. Anyway, so get this. Who knows what an assumption is? Yeah? The assumption is you assume that someone's thinking something or someone's done something. Yes? Did you know the experiences in your life that you've had? By default. Not because you choose to, because of what's happened to you. By default, you fill the assumption with your experience and fill it with it. Did you know that? So if you have a friendship, and that friendship breaks for whatever reason, and then, say, Susie and Donald, Susie finds out from someone else that Donald said something, but Susie had a bad upbringing, I don't know, maybe broken trust, maybe dad wasn't always around to help her. Maybe she would fill her mind up with all these bad things about Donald. When Donald didn't say anything. Has that ever happened to you? Yeah? I've had it happen to me lots of times. I don't know, maybe because of my abrupt and raw speaking, but if we all as believers just believe and walk the walk that we talk, then the church would be much more healthy. Because you can cut the branches of a tree that's causing you havoc, But it's not until you uproot that truth, you know, you know, no more problems. Those issues are in church. And they are here today. And a society that we live in, how easy is it to misinterpret someone? Or to blame someone? Or how easy is it that you can see a situation and it looks bad when it really is? And that's why God has called us to change our minds. What does He say to be? To be transformed and renewed. In what? The mind and what else? Spirit. Everything needs to be renewed. We are all vessels of Christ. Amen? Anyone here a vessel of Christ? Yes? So if we are vessels of Christ, let's be vessels of Christ. I remember hearing someone say, if you're going to speak about it, be about it. If you're going to say that you're a Christian, be a Christian. If you're not, then don't be a Christian. I encourage you to be a Christian. But if you're not going to follow those practices, then save yourself the hardship. Yeah? Well, that's all for me. Love you guys. Thank you so much. God bless you. And we're going to be now and we're going to finish. Alex, you got some announcements?